Is that one? Is this one?
Mm-hmm.
Cool. Hi, everyone, and those joining online. Welcome to the last event of LGBTQIA History Month as part of Art Students Union with our queer alumni panel talk with our lovely speakers. On this lovely evening in East London, we are going to be talking about all things working as a queer creative in London and how we feel about the month as it draws to a close. Just for quick introductions, my name is Katwamba Mutale. I use he, him pronouns. I'm your LCF SPAC officer. And my role today will be your host and your moderator. And just a bit about myself, I graduated from LCF. I studied fashion photography. And yeah, I've just been in this role for a bit over 6 months now. Bit onto housekeeping. So just in terms of housekeeping, fire safety and emergency evacuation, in an event of fire, if there is any, please leave all your belongings and make your way to the fire display exits. And please disperse yourselves out of the building via the main entrance and into the public area away from the building where you wait for the instructions from the designated fire warden. The slides will be available after the recording, and this presentation is being recorded. So if you're asking a question at the end of the questions, please step forward to the microphone. And also, please silence your phones for respect. And please take all your belongings and put your rubbish in the bin at the end of the event. And just for a mature content warning, this panel talk will contain mature adult content during a segment of this talk. That was all. Now on to introductions with our lovely guests. Each of our guests will introduce themselves with these lovely slides that they prepared for us. We will start with Gaby, Jordan, and then Ramel. So take it away.
How long should I make this?
As however long as you want.
Okay. Hi, everyone. I'm Gaby. I graduated from Goldsmiths in 2015 from doing BA Fine Art, so I'm not actually from UAL. But I mostly do painting and filmmaking, and I run a small like project space called Queer Direct. A lot of my practice has kind of like changed a lot over the years, but mostly I'm concerned with like using queer identity or queerness to look at different subject matters. At the moment, I'm looking at kind of what's happening in Palestine, because that's what matters to me the most, and trying to create like a third space to merge those two different topics. With Queer Direct, the project space I mentioned before, it was a project space that was founded in 2017, and I can talk more about it later, but it's basically a artist network, and in the past we've done like different exhibitions, screenings, and it was kind of a self-funded project that has now kind of gone on to become a bit of an educational project. So now I do a little bit of teaching work, a little bit of workshop work. That's I'll keep it short for now, because I'm sure there's other people and more things to say. But yeah, thank you.
Very interesting. Jordan?
Cool.
We have a video for you guys to watch. Which bit? Is it? Thank you.
Start a record label, Miss Fish just did it. Nylon cover 5 minutes. Whoa, we up too hot in the business. About to make a movie independent. Need new trucks independent. I need you to listen to the vision. All your verses sound like dirty dishes. I'm about to clean them in the kitchen. And we making money by the minute. I'm about to do a way different. I am just an icon living.
I am just an icon living. Icon living. I am just an icon living. I am just an icon.
Cool. Thank you very much. My name's Jordan Williams. I am a multidisciplinary creative from Newham, East London. I grew up around here, and I've seen a lot of changes over the years. My practice in terms of being a creative started, I would say, maybe like 2010. I came to UAL via Camberwell. 2010, and then I graduated from Camberwell in 2013, and then I started kind of venturing into the music industry and trying to find my way into the music industry using like visual art. And then several years later, fast forward a few life experiences, one being homelessness, and then the pandemic happened, and then I kind of started focusing on my own practice and making my artwork a bit more about my own personal identity rather than being work for hire. So I launched my company called Adversatile Artists, and at the moment I'm focused on developing a fashion brand called Air, and I'm also producing a TV series that's going to launch that fashion brand of the same name. That's me in a nutshell.
Thank you.
Hello everyone. My name is Ramel Asherad, and I am a fashion designer. I am the founder of Creations by Queen. I'm also a personal stylist, and I'm a model, and I do spiritual work as well. My pronouns are he, they, by the way. I graduated from UCA in 2020, and I studied fashion design. With my brand, Creations by Queen, with everything that I do, actually, when it comes down to creativity, there has to be intention behind what I create. And I like to use the creative practices that I do, I like to use it as a tool of healing, community, and also like self-discovery as well within myself, and using that as a platform to share with others. That's what I do.
Thank you, everyone, for that. So now we're going to move on to the questions. The first question I have for you all is, how did you find being a queer artist at university? Start with you, Gaby.
Can everyone hear me okay, by the way? When I got asked to do this panel, I felt like my brain went into nostalgia mode, because I feel like university, once you're out of it, is something your brain kind of like deletes. And I think as well, like, being a queer person in any institution is difficult, but in university it felt like extra difficult because you're still figuring out who you are. And that was the case for me. So when I think back to doing a BA fine art course from 2012 to 2015, I felt like a lot of the challenges at the time was that there was just complete lack of diversity in the faculty and on the course. There was only one gay male tutor who was 50, and there wasn't even any POC people on the course or anything. So queer art wasn't really made or discussed on the course, even though it had been in art history and stuff. It just felt like it just wasn't happening for one reason or another. So I felt like that kind of led me at university to suppress a lot of things and to kind of make art that I didn't want to make art about. So I felt like I was making a lot of terrible work, just looking at different fillers to try and express myself. But it wasn't happening the way I wanted it to. So I was quite a slow learner. And I felt like the way I coped with all of that was to try and build my own world, a kind of third space which I could go to and try and understand the conflicting emotions I was going through and be okay with that, and just know that I think when you're a queer artist trying to express yourself, it can be a little bit challenging at that time. I'm sure now it's a lot easier.
Yeah, to echo similar thoughts to Gaby, when I was studying, I definitely hadn't even like considered, you know, who I was, I guess, at the time. I think at that time, coming into university, you're kind of, you're not even necessarily daring enough to even call yourself an artist, really. Like, I mean, you are, but it's like you kind of realize that a lot later on that you've always been one. But at that time, when you just about left college and you're coming into university, it's a bit too bold to even consider yourself an artist, let alone have your identity, you know, down packed as well. For me, I would say at that time particularly, I think the main struggle for me was trying to exhibit, I would say, blackness in my work. That's probably like the first layer of like, all right, my identity, I want to express myself. And the first layer that I was kind of struggling to be heard in terms of my work and allow myself to be, you know, feel like I was accepted in the university or even given a level of validation from my tutors. I felt like, you know, being a black male from Newham was kind of like the first kind of like hurdle for me personally. And I would say it wasn't until I left university and several years later that I even then kind of allowed myself the freedom to then also consider what my sexual identity was, and then for it to then layer on feed into my work as well. So yeah, again, it was kind of like a very slow kind of process. And as well, you know, back then the information age isn't what it is today. So generally speaking, information in terms of like what it means to be queer, what it means to be bisexual, it just wasn't as free-flowing as it is today. I feel like it would have taken a lot. It definitely would have happened a lot faster today than it would have back then. Yeah, again, it's a very, very slow transition for me.
Thank you.
Thank you. hello. Is it working?
Yeah.
I would say my experience being queer at university was very... It was very liberating for me. Beforehand, there wasn't a space for me to explore my sexuality, for me to tap into my queerness and my creativity. I never had that space growing up. So when I started uni at the age of 21 and going to like a creative uni, being surrounded by like so many like individuals that are just authentically expressing themselves, being surrounded by art, that was the first time in my life where I felt safe to be myself. And that was the first time I feel like I actually discovered who I was for the first time. I feel like I grew up thinking I was this way from what was projected onto me or how I should be, being a black man or being all of these other labels that was projected onto me. And when I started uni, it was like, freeing myself from all of that and actually starting this journey of, discovering who I truly am. And so, yeah, everything was new to me as well. I didn't dive into anything creative beforehand. So everything was like a very new experience. And it was very liberating and freeing. And I feel like as well, once I got to understand how art and creativity can be used as a way of expression, organically I started to use the projects as a tool of healing and starting to really dissect certain narratives that I've been like either following throughout my life, and a lot of that was to do around like black masculinity and really using my projects as a way to like dissect and break down and try to understand what does black masculinity mean for me, or what does being gay mean for me, what does being queer, all of these things I was discovering through my creativity and my projects and stuff. So for me, my uni experience was like a great foundation for myself in a way. It was almost like a degree of like self-discovery for myself, you know? So yeah.
Thank you. It's really interesting to hear about, from your responses, how it's quite mixed. So for yourself, Gaby and Jordan, you found yourselves having a quite like isolating experience. But for Ramel, you found a quite liberating experience being a queer student at university. So I'm really interested to now find out, how was it like after graduating, being a queer artist yourself?
I think that revelation for me, like Ramel was saying, happened after university, after taking like a bit of a break from whatever psychological damage was happening at university and stuff. But I also felt like I left with a lot of a lot of shame, a lot of internalized homophobia. And I was trying to drop all those categories after university and try and also make art about things that I wanted and the world that I was part of. So I felt like I was trying to stay true to myself and just trusting my gut feelings after university. And there was still a lot of dodgy art that was being made along that process. But then that's kind of at the time when I set up Queer Direct, because I felt like I basically fell into a lot of like subcultures, a lot of like LGBTQIA plus like subcultures, especially artist networks and stuff. And that's kind of how I found my studio. We were kind of in this big shared warehouse in Bermondsey, and I felt like I met all these artists who identified as non-binary, like myself, or just who were not being represented in institutions and galleries. And there were also, with those artists comes like really interesting work and stories that I think can be told. It was around like, I think, 2015 when I graduated, and 2016, 17 when I started like actually making work and stuff. And I felt like as well at that time, kind of like white gay men were taking up all the attention, and it was round then that institutions like the Tate, like the V&A and everything, were putting on evening events and were trying to raise like the queer consciousness amongst like the collection and stuff, and there were all these discussions happening, but it wasn't happening in the right way. Like it was only happening around Pride Month for one evening in a corridor or something, like a late or something. So I felt like I built from that world I was part of and that world I didn't see, and what came out from that kind of more institutional way of representing LGBTQI culture, and what was that subcultural way of doing it. And that's a really interesting mix, I think, when you bring and drag both those worlds together. So I started making art from that point of reference in a way.
That's really positive here that you had a more positive experience after graduating. Mm. Sounds was quite liberating as you found your sense of community as well.
I think I was desperately looking for, I guess, people like me at university. And it did have the LGBT society at the time, but I felt too nervous to go. I didn't really want to go. I think I wanted to find like people with also similar interests who were in the creative circles. And I found that, but it took me years after university to kind of find a network and build upon it and also develop my own language. So, yeah.
As it often does. But thank you for sharing. Over to you, Jordan.
I'm going to need you to repeat the question. But before you do, I want to kind of continue from what we were just talking about in terms of being a black male, in terms of like quite often culturally, you're not even necessarily encouraged to even pursue the arts as well. Like, so there's like a, you know, there's almost like, you know, you're even kind of like crossing the boundaries just by even choosing to be a creative in the first place. So quite often there isn't that like family support or parental support when you're going into these spaces. And for that reason, for me personally, I was only really focused on how to make money, to be honest with you. It wasn't even like a thing of like, you know, what do I actually like? It's more so of what do I think is going to make money? What do I feel like somebody's going to buy into? I studied graphic design, so I was only focused on client relationships and like, you know, responding to briefs. I hadn't really even conceived the idea of what do I want to do, kind of thing. It was like I need to get a job. I need, this needs to make sense financially. Otherwise, it's a wrap kind of thing. So that was kind of like the main focus. But sorry, your question, the question was,
how do you find being a queer artist after graduating?
So after graduation, I would say for me, so I graduated in 2013, but I wouldn't say that I made my first piece of queer content or queer artwork until maybe like 2021, maybe. So it's a good like almost a decade of like still not really kind of giving myself a license to express myself that way creatively. But at the same time, not only giving myself a license, but also the own personal self-discovery of like, you know, kind of like unlearning information that I grew up with in regards to, again, internalized homophobia and feeling like, all right, you know what? Yeah, I want to give myself the freedom to do so. I'll say that... The way it kind of evolved for me. So the pandemic happened, and you know, again, I was homeless just before the pandemic, and then that was like the beginning of like an existential crisis. Mm. And I was like, okay, you know what? I have no choice now but to kind of face myself, and not only just face myself, but also just, you know, accept that it's me. It's all or nothing kind of thing. Like,
yeah.
I need to rely on me. So, you know, there's no getting away from me. So like it or love it, but this needs to make sense kind of thing. So, and that kind of turned in, I think the first kind of like early for me was that spoken word. So, spoken word and poetry was kind of like the first way I found a way to express myself that way. Going to like queer open mic nights. There's quite an interesting queer community poetry scene in like South London, Peckham area that I was frequenting quite a lot. And again, with spoken word, it's like that tool in itself is a way to kind of find your voice. So that kind of gave me the confidence to kind of pull it in other ways as well. And I'm still kind of like figuring that out now. But I'd say, yeah, a lot of the progress to me happened, I guess, post-pandemic.
Thank you. It sounds like you had as well like a liberating experience finding your queer identity. How do you feel now that you've discovered that? Do you have more like liberation to fully express yourself as a queer artist?
Absolutely. Fast forward from spoken word, that then turned into making music, and also along with the music, obviously hip hop has like quite a very synonymous relationship with fashion and music. So I've explored into fashion and expressing myself in that medium as well, which I would say is definitely a lot more, it's not necessarily more diverse than music or diverse in hip hop necessarily, mm-hmm. but it definitely is a lot more welcoming in terms of your sexual identity and queerness for sure. And being able to kind of like, you know, move between the two and, you know, carry ideas from one place to the next is kind of how I've kind of navigated that space in terms of, okay, what can I bring from hip hop into fashion, and what can I bring from fashion into hip hop? And there is definitely a relationship between the two that I'm trying to explore, as well as have my own identity. And, you know, things like like color palettes, for example. Like, so this is a T-shirt I'm wearing that I kind of thought to put together myself, and kind of like thinking about, all right, cool. You know, I guess like quite recently, actually, just again, post the pandemic, I learned that the Bi Pride flag is purple, blue and pink, I think it is.
Yeah.
So small things like that in terms of like, okay, like, you know, what do I want to take from queer culture and bring it, and how is it going to, you know, I guess like influence my work is kind of how I've approached it.
Great, thank you. Last to Ramel.
So I graduated in 2020 during the pandemic. So that was an obstacle within itself.
But I had plans, like when I was graduating, I was like, yeah, I'm going to build my brand and it's going to take off. And yeah, that was a bit delusional. And I feel like once I graduated, I really was humbled by life's experiences. I experienced homelessness too after I graduated. So my focus was not on creating, it was on making sure I meet my basic needs, basically. And once I did get settled in a place, I did start to grow, like gradually grow Creations by Queen. And it's still a process for me now. but yeah, I feel like I was putting a lot of pressure on myself to be something, to put my art out there, to gain a following, to gain, like, make sure that this can, create income and all of this. And it was actually making me kind of, it was draining the passion out of me, basically. And I also started doing like freelance work as well. So I was doing like commissions and stuff for like my friends' projects and whatever. But yeah, it just didn't feel like it was true for me. I felt like I was having this war of like, this is what I'm passionate about, but also I need to make sure that I have a roof over my head and that I eat. So yeah, that was a bit of a challenge. And I feel like now I have like a different way of connecting with my creativity. I had cancer in 2022, testicular cancer. That was another life experience that had to make me, not make me, but it kind of made me pause in terms of like my creative journey and my career. It was a space that kind of allowed me to actually come back to why I want to do what I want to do and how I want to show up, not only for myself, but for like my queer siblings too. And I feel like that experience, it did make me have to take a break for like a year. So the whole of the last year, I wasn't creating, I wasn't doing any freelance work, any styling or anything like that. But I really needed that time to come back to myself. And I think it's not, it's not spoken about, like making sure that you're looking after yourself and that you're resting and, you know, you're having that time of hibernation. I feel like that's something that we do need to value, and it doesn't make us any less of a creative. And that was something I was battling a lot with last year, is like, oh, like I'm not creating, but these times my mental health is not balanced right now. So that's more of a priority. The fact that I'm not creating doesn't mean that I'm lacking in any way. Like, this is the time for me to kind of rejuvenate and look after myself. And through that whole process, it's actually inspired a lot of things in my creative practices now. And I feel like I was kind of going all around. But with the personal styling that I do, it's very like, I call it mindful styling, because it's something where I kind of take my clients on a journey of self-discovery through clothes, and allowing clothes to be a means of healing, and allowing clothes to get to know different versions of yourself or different personalities that you may not have got to know within yourself yet. And so, yeah, I think with all of this, I've just learned that there's no rush. I'm still like Creations by Queen. I haven't released a collection or anything. Like, I've been involved in like an exhibition, and I've done like a mini collection for that and stuff, but it's still something that's growing, and I'm not in a rush to, I don't know, expose my art or to make it something. It's more of a personable thing for me, and something that I enjoy and I'm taking my time with.
Thank you for sharing. And yeah, I'm very sorry to hear that you had to go through that, mm-hmm. having like personally got in touch with you whilst you're doing that. It's very sorry to hear. One thing that you really brought out from that conversation was the idea of like not rushing, mm-hmm. and not feeling like you have to be at this place, because often as queer artists or queer people living in London, we're faced with like all these things with rent and how to make everything, having to make ends meet, and that sometimes life can get in the way, especially for queer POC that can face more obstacles in the way. So I wanted to want you to talk more about how you feel having taken that break now that you've had to go through that.
I feel rejuvenated. I feel like I really spent that time pouring into myself. I really spent that time, as challenging and as dark as it was, I feel like the darkness is always a space for us to grow and to evolve. And that was the case for me. I feel like as well, like I said, I had testicular cancer, and a lot of my work is based around Black masculinity. So within that whole space as well, it really made me go more deeper within that. And so now when I'm creating, I can see how I'm channeling certain emotions that I was feeling, whether that was rage or whether that's shame, humiliation, instead of allowing these emotions to like almost swallow me, I now channel these emotions in a healthy way through my art. And I feel like, yeah, the past year has kind of guided me guided me in expressing myself in that way. So, yeah.
Thank you. That sounds very empowering. On to our last question for this segment. In a few words, I'll start with first you, Ramel, again. What advice would you give yourself having graduated?
There's no rush. I think it's very important that we understand that there's no rush, and we all have our own like unique journeys, and I feel like it's going to be unique for us. And I think the most important thing is our relation, like how we connect with our art and how we connect with like the stuff that we create. I feel like that's the most important thing, and then everything else kind of organically like unravels. So yeah,
really good advice. And for you, Jordan?
Thank you. It's similar words, I guess. Yeah, don't rush, but I guess more so from like don't forget to live. I feel like I spent a lot of time living to become something. I don't know what I thought I was going to become, but I felt like, in regards to my art, like, again, it was like, I always saw it as a means to an end as opposed to just being. And don't forget to live, because ultimately, you know, I feel like having a life and, you know, and being present in life also is kind of what kind of would enrich whatever work you do, ultimately. Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah, I was also thinking the same thing, that life is kind of your life is really important, like the personal relationships you have with, say, your friends or whoever your chosen family are, or whoever your actual family are or something. I feel like we sometimes forget that in the journey to becoming a creative. So that's always really important to remember. And if I'm thinking of what I would tell myself, I would probably tell myself to also be a bit more brave. I think bravery is like, it was needed for me in my case. And also just to work on self-esteem. I think self-esteem is really important. And when I was graduating, I think I really disregarded that because I felt like I was just rushing. And things do take time, like you were both saying. I graduated in 2015 and now in 2024. And I only feel like now I'm semi-happy with where I'm at in my career as well. So it does just take a while, and that's okay. So yeah,
thank you all for sharing that. Now we're going to move on to the second half of this panel talk, which will be talking about what this month means to us in general. So this month's theme is medicine as part of LGBTQ History Month. However, it can have many different meanings to us, especially during the political climate that we're in. So I'm going to ask. First with you, Gaby, what does LGBTQIA History Month mean to you currently as a queer artist?
Yeah, That's a big question. Yeah. I feel like that I was aware it was History Month, but it's not something like, oh, it's History Month. Yeah. I feel like I'm always thinking about it. Mm-hmm. It's not just this month I'm like, a light bulb goes yeah. off. Like, but for me, it just, I think the core of it is that, like, I feel like as queer people, we can often see like our freedoms be revoked. Yeah. And in history, you can see reiterations of history re-happen. Like, especially when I'm thinking of the political climate, I'm thinking of like the rise in conservatism and the far rights and how bad like trans rights are in the UK. So I think about that a lot, and it makes me want to be more activism focused, and also to remind myself that activism doesn't take a lot of money sometimes. It's like driven by people power. Mm-hmm. You don't always need a lot of space. Two weekends ago, I went to this talk in Peckham by the BLGC, which is the Black Lesbian Gay Center. And they were saying that basically, yeah, you like back then they were just using the really limited resources that they had, and how they're saying that the work kind of still needs to carry on in terms of like gaining our freedoms and gaining wider LGBTQIA plus representations in all industries mm-hmm. and stuff and fighting discrimination. I think also it makes me think of like a lot of writers that I like and theorists. Like I think of like Judith Butler, and mm-hmm. Sarah Schulman, and also Octavia E. Butler. Like I feel like queer culture has generated such rich like culture in terms of like reading, writing, art. So it makes me think that I'm so lucky to be a part of that and to still work with the legacy of that. So yeah.
Well, that was really insightful to hear. One thing you mentioned about was about the activism mm-hmm. side of things. Do you think within the queer community there's a lot of that going on at the moment?
I don't know. I don't know every queer person, but I do think that, like, I feel like there is, like, I feel like people are revved up in general yeah. in this country. So I feel like if you're queer, you're probably even more revved up. Like, yeah, so I feel like there's a lot of that happening. And I think even just thinking about queer activism, like, for me, I find it really interesting about how, like, queerness can become, like, a lens to yeah. look at other activism or political issues and make it intersectional. I don't know. Yes, sorry. I don't know if I've gone over anything.
No, that was perfect. Thank you. Over to you, Jordan.
What this month means to me is really discovery for me. I would say that in terms of like culture and the history of it, it's for me, it's time to learn something new, to be honest with you. LGBTQ plus history naturally finds its way into my ecosystem. The way this panel came about actually was just happen chance. I think it was the email that I saw from a student union. I think that might have been the first time I knew it was the month, to be honest with you. And again, I think I only discovered what Bi-Pride month was maybe like a year or so ago. So it's still quite like fresh to me. But also I would say not only discovery, but it's also an opportunity to discover myself, but also I guess feel more encouraged, feel more emboldened. As the time passes in terms of like, you know, how am I going to delve further into my own queerness and my own identity just by being on this panel. You know, I'm learning things, and I'm sure I'm going to watch this back just to pick up the names you just mentioned also. But it's a time for me to kind of, learn and unlearn and, just be a bit more aware of what's going on. What was the other part of your question?
Oh, that was it. But just following on what you said, do you think that the UK in general needs to do more to like spread awareness about this month? Because in the UK, February is LGBTQIA History Month. But I feel like sometimes it's not as mentioned about as is Black History Month in October.
Right. Well, actually, so that was, yeah. So to answer your question, yes, I would say, yeah, it definitely needs to do more awareness for sure. And me particularly, you know, I'm probably not, like, I definitely live a probably relatively isolated life in general anyway. I'm not on social media. So, you know, like, I couldn't even tell you, to be honest with you, how little or how more needs to be done in that regard. But what I was going to say, though, in terms of, like, I guess in comparison to Black History Month, I would say that what also it means for me also is, like, coming into LGBTQ plus history as a Black person, it also kind of, I'm also reflective on, I guess, like, how much, I guess, progress this country has in comparison to where I'm ethnically from.
Mm-hmm.
In terms of, like, okay, what the UK has in terms of, like, promotion and freedom compared to Jamaica, for example, is, like, worlds apart, to be fair. So I wouldn't even, like, even really have the criticism to say, oh, the UK is not doing enough. To be honest with you, I just wouldn't. You'd have to tell me that they're not doing enough, to be honest with you. But, yeah, and then continuing that, I also kind of, you know, in terms of, like, where things are currently politically and how, you know, the world is right now, I would say that in general, you know, I don't know, in terms of, like, just activism as a whole, I would say that it's like, I guess I try to kind of be a bit more reserved in terms of, like, how things are kind of, like, playing out, you know, like, well, I guess, like, what, you know, what the, I guess, the long-term kind of, like, picture is. You know, I would agree that, like, in this country, there's definitely a lot more protests and a lot more media and a lot more, you know, civil unrest when it comes to these kind of issues. But it's a very noisy time.
Yeah.
In general right now. You know, it's kind of hard to kind of tell, like, what's relatively more noise or what in compared to other topics, to be fair. You know, I'm not sure what, you know, I don't know if it's correct to kind of compare one movement to another in that regard. Yeah.
Thank you. Lastly, Ramel.
I would say this month is definitely a month for me where it's like honoring our queer ancestors that has paved the way for us to be here in this moment, in a space where we can express ourselves and all of that. I do feel like as well the whole sense of community is very important, and I feel like for me personally, I've always longed for this sense of, like, community and feeling, like, this whole sense of, like, belonging. And I feel like the more I'm coming, like, more in touch within myself and more comfortable within my sexuality and stuff, it's like I'm opening myself up more to community. And what I find so beautiful is that we can always remind each other of our truth. And there's, like, for me, I've dealt with so much shame. Like, I felt so much shame, so much negative things towards who I am. But every time I'm in, within community, I get reminded that my existence is enough, that I am enough, that I am worthy. And I feel like that connection, us reminding each other of our truths, can really help to really deal with the challenges that we've been facing. And I think togetherness and oneness is really important for us to move forward. So yeah, that's one thing. And also as well, like, it's very important for me to be radical in how I like to really evoke, like, being radical in my art and even just self-expression. I think as well, like, how I express myself, it draws attention. And I've actually loved that, because it's like the looks that I may be receiving from people is giving me that kind of like, oh, it's making them think. Like, the way I'm expressing myself is making them think, whether they're projecting either hate or whatever, is shifting something within them. And that's radical. That's being radical within itself. So it's like, oh, it's like, there's so much that we can do within our daily lives that can create the change that we want as well. And I think that's important to realize as well. So yeah.
Thank you for sharing. I really like what you said about being radical and like finding your truth. I feel like a lot of people can use that right now. But yeah, I would like to have some follow-up questions to that, but I'm just wary of time. And I want to ask the audience if they have any questions they would like to ask the speakers, just to give yourselves opportunity to get to know them a bit more. Does anyone have any questions? Don't be shy. Any? No.
Like always, but I just don't know how to work.
You can try. Oh, you need to use a microphone though. Just. Thank you.
Does this work? Okay. Yeah, I think it's just adding to the discussion about Queer History Month as a time
I think you might
to like reflect on the history that we have, and but I just wanted to ask the panel if you have any honest feelings about if you feel there's pressure from this month where it sort of like puts a spotlight on us. And in that respect, is Queer History Month, who's it for? Is it for us, or is it for the wider world to sort of take notice of? I suppose, like, this is specifically in the West as well. But yeah, that's my question.
That's a really good question. You worded it absolutely fine. Gaby, would you like to start first in answering that?
Yeah, I think about that as well, because that's when you asked me about Queer History Month. I was like, it's not something that I think about specifically this month. I'm thinking about it all the time. Like, I'm always thinking about queer history. I'm always trying to engage with queer culture. So I think it's, who's it for is a really good question. I don't think it's something I can personally answer. But I do think it's, history is really easily forgotten. And even, for example, even when I think of my history, like, I will go to a museum, say the War Museum, for example. I'll spend 2 hours and then I'll forget something like a month later. So I think it is really good to still engage in history and have a history month, even if there is the side effect of it, of being like, who's it for? It's a bit cringe, like, and stuff like that. But I don't know. I think queer history is also really rich. And even if that month exists just for one or two straight people who maybe have never engaged with it, then I think that's the success of it in a way for me. So yeah.
For me, I think it's like, I feel like I'm taking opportunity to be as selfish as possible, to be honest with you. That's like, it's important about to just to not forget yourself personally. Like, definitely there is a, self-care is probably like the biggest win, really and truly. Because like, if you're, there's pressure all year round to not care about yourself and to not feel like you're worthy, and to not feel like, you know, you're enough. So I feel like it's just an excuse to be, you know, to think about yourself and to care for yourself. And I feel like that in itself is the victory in terms of, like, you know, what the message is to the rest of the world. Like, seeing that, you know, okay, despite all of the pressures to oppress yourself, or the pressures that are coming at you, yet still you are caring for yourself. You're still, you know, having a life of your own and finding joy in the things that you do. Yeah, that's my answer.
Thank you.
I do think that History Month, like Queer History Month, is like, it's definitely needed, just for us to remind ourselves, like, where we have come from and how much we've had to do, especially, like I mentioned before, with our queer ancestors and stuff, like, how much they've had to do, sacrifice their lives in order for us to be here today. So I do feel like there does need to be, like, a time to dedicate and honour that. But with a lot of, like, months, like Black History Month and stuff, it's like, is it really for what, like, is it really for what the month is actually like to, if that makes sense? I feel like a lot of, especially within, like, Western culture, a lot of things is, like, performative and, like, image and consumerism, blah, blah, blah. So I think the important thing is, how do we personally connect with, like, these periods of time, or, like, how do we personally connect with this month, and what kind of stuff does it bring up for us personally? And it can always shift, it can always change. But yeah, I feel like it's a very much it's very much a personable thing. So yeah,
thank you for sharing. What I loved about your answers is how, like, you have your own personal touch to how you redefine the month, which I think, like, we need. And I just feel like your point about making sure that we can have these histories for people to remember, because, as you said, it can be easily forgotten, which we don't want to have. I think we have time for one more question, if everybody has one. No? Yeah? Could you pass the microphone? Go ahead.
Again, not totally sure how to sort of word it, but I guess it's an extension of the, like, who is it for, but rather than, like, for about the month, more as in when you're making your artwork. I guess I'm asking this from a bit more of a, like, fine art perspective, as opposed to, not that you're not artists when you're designers, but when you're doing something which is so much of a personal practice element, then how do you, whether you want the label of, like, queerness sort of defined to your work, I guess, and I might as well make it personal, because that's what it is, in that, like, I'm very happy to define as queer, but I'm kind of like, all of the work that I make is inherently queer because I am. It's kind of like, I don't need to do anything to make it queer, because it is, because that's in who I am and the topics that I want to, you know, that's just me. So it's kind of like, I guess it's a discussion of, yeah, like you said, who is it for when you're kind of labeling yourself as queer, or your art or your product as queer? Is that, does that make sense as a question?
I think that's an interesting question, because that's something I thought a lot about when I was doing exhibitions and stuff. And and you can be, like, typecasted and be included in only queer shows, and then you're like, oh God, do I just exist in this vacuum? Like, yeah. And you really want to branch out. So I do think we need to get rid of, also, like, categories are useful, but they also have this side effect where they're not useful. And I think sometimes it's about just abolishing that system a little bit. For example, I'm like, yeah, it's like what you're saying. Everything I make is inherently queer, but it's not always explicitly queer. And that's, like, an interesting place, I think, to try and make work from and try and articulate and stuff. And it makes, your question also makes me think of, like, language, and how I just feel like language is always a point of struggle. and it's always changing, especially in the queer community. And that's something I'm personally like trying to embrace, that we're always changing the way we self-identify or the language we use within our community. And that's something not to be feared, but that we should embrace. And it's really beautiful. And and people shouldn't categorize it. It should be like, it should exist in different spheres and universes. And queer artists should be included in like group exhibitions. And I don't know. And yeah, yeah, that, I think that's my point.
I think for me, I see it as like, I definitely have like done a lot of work personally to kind of not label myself as anything. You know, there is like already the pressure of like, you know, oh, I need to show up as the black guy. Do you know what I mean? That's like, that's already the pressure that I feel like I've done work to just not, you know, walk into a room feeling like I need to show up as anything. So I don't, I'm definitely not, I'm not going to add queerness onto that either. Like, I'm not going to now, like, you know, I'm not like, because even like for me, in terms of like what I thought I was doing by coming out, for example, I thought, no, like, I'm not coming out. I've been me. That's it, really. Like, that's, you know, I've tried to kind of like streamline that as simply as possible. Like, I'm not here to have a whole conversation. I'm not here to, you know, like, you know, I don't know, whatever is in the movies about what coming out is supposed to look like, I'm not interested in that. I'm just, you know, I showed up. You know, if we hadn't had a conversation about queerness before today, we're having it now. Don't expect to have it tomorrow. If you miss it last week, you missed it last week. I had it last week. I know I had it last week. We don't need to have it again. That's kind of where I stand with that kind of thing. So I don't really, yeah, in terms of labels, I don't really feel like I want to adopt any kind of label. Just showing up as myself in any kind of environment as much as possible. Like, even, you know, I guess coming here is like, I'm in the queer, quote unquote, environment, but I don't feel the need to show up as a musician, or I don't feel the need to show up as a hip-hop artist. I'm just me, kind of thing. I don't really, yeah, I tried to spend a little time as thinking about who or how I'm going to be perceived in any environment as much as possible, because I feel like I've done a lot of struggling with that before coming to this point now. Yeah.
Thank you. I would say, especially with the space that I'm creating, Creations by Queen, it really does try. I really do try and take away the labels. I feel like we do. Some people may feel comfortable with labels because it helps with like identity and stuff. But I feel like for me, I just want to be, I don't want to feel, I feel like labels for me is kind of restrictive. And I feel like as humans, we're always shifting, we're always like evolving, but our perceptions are always changing, all of these things. So it's like, it's very important that I stay open. And even at the beginning, I'm listening, like I'm a fashion designer and all of that, but even that is like, that can shift. That can shift to mine. I can be like, I don't want to do that anymore. I'm going to do something else. So it's like really for me not attaching it too much to my identity, and just allowing, like for me as well, like my art has really opened me up to meeting different parts of myself that I did not know before. But if I was so like attached to certain labels, I would not have given myself permission to have that space to meet those different versions of myself. So yeah, and I feel like as well, it's kind of interesting because I'm sitting here thinking, and it's like Creations by Queen would authentically, I guess, or organically be a queer space because I'm a queer individual, but a lot of my inspiration or a lot of the concepts I look at is around black masculinity, and that's not just queerness. That's that's like that's black man, and so that's taking it. That's not just queer anymore. That's like looking at black men. That's like looking at people like, I don't know, my father or the black men within my life that are not queer. And having so much, I'm learning so much within that field or that space within myself because I am a black man. So yeah, I don't know. It's just, it's very important that I, don't get too attached to the labels and don't make them my identity. For me personally, obviously, it's how we can identify with others in society and stuff, but within myself, just not getting attached to the labels. Yeah,
hope that answers your question. We loved all your responses and how you made it individual, and I think it's really important that you all redefined it to your own terms, and how just being what you are can exist in that space, which is really insightful. So thank you all for sharing. That is all for it today. Thank you all for coming. I just have to say there's some free snacks at this corner, so feel free to grab as many as you want. Thank you all for watching. Hope you enjoyed this panel talk, and thank you.
Cool. Thank you as well.